Hey guys, welcome to another Python tutorial for beginners. So in today's video, we're continuing to talk about the second half of the set method video. So in our last video, we've talked about union, intersection, and difference. And so in this video, we'll be talking about symmetric difference, edge disjoint, edge subset, and edge superset. So let's get into this. So the first method that we'll be talking about is the symmetric difference. And as you can see in the diagram, the symmetric difference gets the set of elements that are either in set A or set B, but not in both, meaning they're not in the intersection. And just like how we call the other method, we can call the symmetric difference method with two sets that we have here, set A and set B. So if you look at the set A and set B, the common elements between set A and set B are element C and element 3 here. So if I were to call the symmetric difference method either in set A or set B, the result should be everything except the element C and element 3 because those two are the common elements between set A and set B. So let me first call the symmetric difference method on set A. So I can print set A.symmetric difference and then put the set B as the argument. And I can also do the same thing in the set B. So I can do print set B.symmetric difference and then put the set A as the argument. And if I run this, then you will see a two exactly same set of results. So basically the symmetric difference method returned everything except the common element as shown in the diagram. So it returned everything except C and 3, which are the only two common elements between set A and set B. And unlike the other method that we have talked about, the symmetric difference method only takes a single argument. So that means that if you have a set C here, you have to actually perform a separate symmetric difference action rather than trying to put the set C as another argument into the existing call. And we can also perform the symmetric difference method using the special character caret. So we can do print set A caret set B, which is identical to the first print statement that we have. And I can also do opposite here. So print set B caret set A. So this will be identical to the same print statement that we have here. So if I run this one more time, then you will see a four exactly identical result. The first half coming from this print statement, and then the last half coming from this caret method. Okay, so now let's move on to the symmetric difference update method. So symmetric difference update. So this method updates a set with the result of symmetric difference. So if I were to call symmetric difference update method on the set A and then put the set B as the argument, then what's going to happen is that the set A will be updated with the result that we see down here, which is the result of the symmetric difference. So let's actually test that out. So I can do set A the symmetric difference update method and then put the set B as the argument. And if I print set A and print set B here and run it, then you can see that the set A was updated with the result of the symmetric difference, while the set B actually remained as is because we haven't actually called the symmetric difference update method on the set B. So as you can see, the set B have a CDE345, which is exactly what we are seeing here for the set B, and set A was updated with the result of the symmetric difference. Okay, so moving on to our next method, is superset. So this method checks whether a set is a superset of another set, meaning the set A that we have includes all the elements in set B. Then we can say that set A is a superset of set B. So let me first create a two set here. So I can do a set A, 1, 2, 3, and some string A and B, and set B, 1, 2, 3, as well as A here. So we have two sets here. So if you look at these two sets, we can clearly say that set A is the superset of the set B because set A contains all the elements that set B contains and it has one more element here. So let's check that by calling the is superset method. So I can do print set A is superset and put the set B as the argument. So this method call is basically checking is set A the superset of the set B. So if I run this, then you will see a true because set A is indeed the superset of the set B. So let's try the opposite here. So print set B is superset set A. And if I run this one more time, then this time you will see first, which makes sense because set B is not a superset of the set A because set A contains all the elements that set B contains plus it contains one more element. So in this case, its superset method is returning first because set B is the subset of the set A, not the superset. So then now let's try to modify one of the elements in the set A. So I'm going to modify this A to a C. And if I run this one more time, then you will see a first and first. And this makes sense because the set A is no longer the superset of the set B because it does not contain all the elements that the set B contains because of the difference that we have here. So the set A contains C, while the set B contains A. So the set A is no longer the superset of the set B. Then now let's try to make the set A and set B exactly identical. So I'm gonna delete these two elements. I'm gonna put A here. So set A and set B is now exactly identical. And if I run this method call one more time, then you will see a true and true. And this makes sense as well, because now the set A contains all the elements that the set B contains, and vice versa, the set B contains all the elements that the set A contains. So when you call the isSuperset method, either in set A or set B, it's gonna return true, because you can actually find all the elements that you are looking for in order to actually make this logic here, isSuperset. Okay, so moving on to the next method, we're gonna talk about isSubset. So isSubset checks whether a set is a subset of another set. So let me simply create two sets here. So set A, 1, 2, 3, and then set B is 1, 2, 3, as well as A. So we have two sets here, and as you can see, set B contains all the elements that the set A contains. So in this case, set A is a subset of the set B, while the set B is the superset of the set A because it contains all the elements that the set A contains plus one more element here. So let's check that. So print set A dot is subset, and then put the set B as the argument. And if I run this, then you will see a true, and this makes sense because all the elements in the set A is in the set B, and set B contains one more element. So set B is the superset of the set A, and set A is the subset of the set B. And let me also do the opposite here. So print set B dot is subset and set A. And if I run this one more time, then in this case, you receive a first because set B is a superset, not a subset. And that's why it's returning a first. So let's try to perform the similar exercise that we did in the is superset. So if I change this 3 to 4 here, and if I run this one more time, then you receive a first and first. And this makes sense as well because all the elements in the set A is not in the set B. And so the set B is not a superset of the set A, and set A is not a subset of the set B because there is a discrepancy that we see here. So then same thing, let's try to make the set A and set B identical. So I'm gonna change this to 3 and delete this A here. And if I run this, then you will see a true and true. And just like the isSuperset method, because the order elements in the set A in the set B and vice versa, both of them will return true because it actually makes sense to say that set A is a subset of the set B, and set B is a subset of the set A because the element in set A and set B are identical. Okay, so finally to the last method of the set data type, we're gonna talk about the is disjoint. So is disjoint basically checks whether two sets have no common element, as you see in the Venn diagram right now here. So let me first create a two sets here. So set A, I can say 1, 2, 3, and then set B, I can say 5, 6, and 7. And as you can see, there are no common elements between set A and set B. So if I call print set A is disjoint on the set B, and then vice versa, print set B is disjoint set A. And if I run this, then you'll see a true and true because set A and set B have no common elements. So these two sets are considered to be a disjoint set, as you see in the Venn diagram. There are no common elements, and that's why the is disjoint method is returning true regardless of which set that you are calling this method from. So what happens if I change this set A, one of the value, to a 5? So then now we have one element that are common between set A and set B. So if I run this one more time, then you will see a first and first, and this is expected because now they are no longer disjoint. The intersection will now have a one element, which is 5, and that's why the is disjoint method is returning first. Okay, so now we are all done with the set data type and its method. Let's have a quick example of how we can apply what we learned with a bit more practical example. So let's say that we have three different sets, as you see right here, and each set is representing each individual with its own programming languages under their belt. So by looking at this data, let's say that the first question that we want to ask is, what is the entire list of the programming languages among these three people? So what is the list of programming languages among three people? So in this case, we can use the union method because the union method will return all the programming languages that are being used by these three people here. So what we can do is Danny, actually, let me set it as a variable. So all programming language, and then I can say Danny.union, and then put the Eddie and Jenny as the argument. So in this case, it doesn't really matter in which set that I'm calling the union method on, because union method returns the entire list of the programming languages anyway, regardless of which set that you are calling the union method on. And after that, I can say print all programming languages, and then put the variable right next to it. And if I run this, then you will see all programming languages with a set that shows up the entire list of the programming languages among these three people without the duplicates. So that is the result of the union method. And now we have the complete set of the programming languages that are being used by these three individuals here. Okay, so then the next question that I want to ask is, what are the common programming languages being used by all three individuals that we have here? So for this, we can use the intersection method. So what are the common programming languages being used by three individuals? And for this, I can also create a new variable. So common programming languages. And then I can also use the Danny as the set that I'm going to call the intersection method, because it doesn't really matter which set that you are calling the intersection method, as long as you pass all the other sets that you want to compare as the argument. So I want to say Danny.intersection, and then put Eddie and Jenny as the argument. And if I print common programming languages and then say common here, and if I run this, then you will see a print statement saying common programming languages with one language, which is Java. So if we look at the set here, the Java is the only language that are common in Danny, Eddie, and Jenny. None of the other languages are common, so this Java actually makes sense. And so that this is the only common programming language among these three people. Okay, so moving on to the next question. Now let's say that we want to know, what are the programming languages that are specific to each individual? In other words, what are the programming languages that only this individual have under their belt? So for that, we can use the difference method. So let me write down the question here. So what are the programming languages that are specific to each individual? So let me first copy this set down here so that we can actually see. Okay, see one more time down here. And then what we can do here is that we can create three separate variables, because we want to know the programming languages specific to each individual, and we have three individuals, so I'm going to create three. So I say programming languages specific to Danny. And then what we can do here is the Danny.difference. And since we are comparing the Danny against the two other individuals, we have to put Eddie and Jenny as the argument here. And then same thing for Eddie. So I can do programming languages specific to Eddie. And then I can do Eddie.difference. And then we can put Danny and Jenny. So please note that I'm not passing the same argument as the Danny, because now I'm calling the difference method on Eddie, so that you want to actually compare with the two other individuals, which is the Danny and Jenny. And same thing for the Jenny here. So specific to Jenny, and then we can say Jenny.difference. And then in this case, I want to put Danny and Eddie. And then let's say that, let's just print this out here. So programming languages specific to Danny, and then print maybe specific to Eddie as well as the Jenny. So programming, here we go. And then if I run this, then you will see three different sets here. The first set is an empty set. So this syntax basically means that you don't have any element in the set. So this first print statement is coming from this print statement right here. So what this means here is that the programming languages specific to Danny, there is none. So if you look at the data, the Python, Java, JavaScript, SQL, and C# is all being used by either Eddie and Jenny. So there is no specific programming language that are only being used by Danny here. That's what the empty set means. And if you look at the second print statement, the programming languages specific to Eddie, we see two elements here, the R and Scala. So if we look at the set here, so Eddie have the R and Scala as the programming languages that the only Eddie can do, but no one else. And that's what it means. language. And if you look at the last print statement, which is the programming language is only specific to Jenny, so HTML, C++, and CSS are the programming languages that only Jenny can do, but no one else. And lastly, let's try to figure out what are the programming languages that are unique to both Eddie and Jenny here, meaning what are the programming languages that are either Eddie or Jenny have, but not in both. So for that, we can use the symmetric difference method that we have talked about in today's video. So what I can do here is I use Eddie as the calling set. So Eddie.symmetric difference, and then put the Jenny as the argument. And if I just print this out, and then if I run this, then you will see this set with all the programming languages. So we can consider this list as the programming languages either in Eddie or Jenny, but not in both. In other words, we can actually consider this as all the programming languages that Eddie and Jenny contain minus the common elements that the Eddie and Jenny has, which is the language Java here. So if you look at the list, you will see all the languages except Java. Okay guys, that's it for this video. We've now talked about all Python data types with some basic fundamentals about programming. So in our next video, we'll start getting into loops, talking about for loops and while loops with various different examples. So please stay tuned. And if you haven't already subscribed, please click the subscribe and like button. Thank you so much for watching and hope to see you in next videos.